and welcome to the latest episode of the Good Dram Show with me, Chris Goodrum. Right, okay, just like to say a really, really big thank you for all the messages and the nice messages that I got for doing last week's Geneva episode of the show that was seems to go down pretty well, and yeah, it was just nice to get some really nice feedback. So anyway, we're not doing Geneva this week. We've done that. We're not going to do gin because we've done that. We're going to go back to tasting some whiskey, and I thought let's do something new and some new releases and things like that. And it just happened to, I've got five new releases and one, well, maybe not quite so new, but it kind of made up the tasting, if you see what I mean. So as you can see from the title page, we're looking at the two of the three Campbeltown distilleries, Glen Scotia and Springbank. Now, I've done several episodes of the show on both of these before, but new releases, always nice to look at them. I mean, if you take Glen Scotia, for example, for absolutely years, all they released was the 12-year-old in the green tube. I mean, pleasant enough. And then they decided to have a revamp, and I did an episode of the show, I think, on that. And there were sort of odd tins with cows on them, if I remember rightly. And they did, what, a 10, a 12... 15, 17, 21, I think. I mean, the 12 and the 21 were really very, very good and just showed how good a distillery Glen Scotia actually is. That the rest were, for one reason or another, not quite, I didn't think quite there. But anyway, they've had yet another revamp. So, you know, it goes for donkey's years, nothing changes, and then suddenly in the space of a few years, it's all changed, you know. So we're going to have a look at the new releases from that. And Springbank, you know, a perennial favourite of mine, it has to be said. And the distillery kindly send me samples. You know, it'd be rude not to actually taste them and share them with you guys, wouldn't it? So we're going to be looking at two brand new releases from them. Like I said, along with just shoehorning the third in, which was a release from last year. But yeah, well, it's an interesting bottling. So. Anyway, I don't need to go into any great detail about the history because I've done both of those distilleries before, so you probably heard it all before. But anyway, so we'll just introduce this afternoon's little lineup then. It's been a one-night stand, then you walk in there long. Okay, so as I was saying, we're going to kick off with Glen Scotia. We're going to start with called the Double Wood. This is bottled at 46%. Spends most of its most of its life it was spent in the spirit was aged in first fill bourbon casks and then finished off in ex Pedro Ximenez sweet sherry. So it would be interesting to see how that balances. You know, it's always a tricky one when you're playing with finishes. Second is a straight 15-year-old, again bottled at 46%. Aged in ex bourbon casks. And then finally of the three new releases from Glen Scotia, we're going to be looking at the Victoriana, which is the cask strength release, all aged in American oak bourbon casks and finished in charred casks. I'm guessing fairly heavily charred American oak casks, and I'm guessing from the term of the name Victoriana, they're kind of trying to hark back to maybe what the distillery was producing back in the Victorian period, I'm guessing. But anyway, we shall see what that tastes like. Then we're going to move on to Springbank. First new release is the Springbank 1999 16-year-old local barley, bottled at 54.3. Now, I believe that Springbank will probably be the first distillery to start using local barley well before certain other distilleries started down that kind of route. I believe that those bottlings finished around about 2001, so it's nice to see the local barley return. The barley for this particular bottling was sourced from Low Macrymore Farm. So it's, as you know, I'm skeptical, should we say, about the whole concept of terroir in whiskey. Certainly exists in wine, and I think it's because the process from you know, the grape to the finished article is pretty much one process. You pick your grapes, you ferment it, you make the wine. And so the elements of the terroir, the earth and what have you kind of come through, because there's not too much, too many processes in between, you know, beginning and the finished article. Whereas with whiskey, there's, you know, fermentation, double distillation, sometimes triple distillation, and you've got you know, a layering up of flavors. And you know, you can taste barley obviously in whiskey, but I'm just wondering whether there is a difference between, you know, sort of barley grown on this farm and barley grown on that farm that makes it into the final product. I'm guessing the only way that you could truthfully say is to basically taste new make spirit from each of these things, because that would at least then, you know, give you an idea if there was a difference. It's the same with organic and non-organic barley. You know, again, I'm kind of skeptical of the differences between the two, but anyway, that's, you know, that's for another day, I think. Anyway, second new release from the Springbank Distillery is the perennial 12-year-old cask strength. This year's bottling is bottled at 54.1 and is aged in ex-sherry casks. I'm guessing by the colour, probably refill. And finally, although, like I said, this is not a brand new bottling, this was released last year, it is the Longrow Red 12-year-old, which is very, very good. Oops, kind of giving the game away there, but anyway. So it spends 11 years in ex-American oak, and it's finished for 1 year in ex-New Zealand Pinot Noir casks. So big peat and wine and, ooh, yeah, it's a ride. Anyway, so that's this afternoon's little tasting. Let's kick off with the Glen Scotia then. Okay, so let's see what the double cask gives us in, shall we? First off, really clean spirit, really nice. Subtle sherry notes, just a sort of a little sort of PXE kind of dry grape wininess. But it's got some lovely barley character, a little bit of salt, some marzipan, certainly coming from the American oak, nutty. A lot of American oak coming through now. I mean, the sherry finishing is very, very subtle. And that's a lovely nose. Really well balanced. Touch of licorice, earth. And all the while you've got that little bit of sherry sweetness, the sort of slightly treacly, dried grape, winey sweetness. And it's all just really very, very harmonious. Not much more you can say apart from, you know, really impressed. Incidentally, the first time I tasted this was for the current issue of the Whiskey magazine, and I kind of figured out what it was. Palate. That's got a lovely finish. Kind of kicks off with more of the PX kind of fruit, sort of the treacle, the wininess, the raisins, and then a little bit of gentle sort of slightly dusty, slightly earthy peat kind of comes through. A little bit of American oak, a little bit of marzipan, and then we're back to the sherry on the finish. A little bit more treacly on the finish, a little sweeter, but real salty intensity, which kind of balances that and just stops it all becoming too sweet, and it's just that beautifully succulent finish. Like I said in the tasting notes for the whiskey magazine, they've really upped their game on this one. This is a fabulous bottle of whiskey, and it is not particularly expensive either, so bonus. Moving on to the 15-year-old, let's see what the nose gives us on this end, shall we? Crisper, obvious, noticeable age to the aromas. It's got that almost sort of starting to become kind of baked fruity kind of age to it. Again, some lovely American oak, subtle, bit of barley, quite sweet barley in actual fact. Just a little hint of peat, just a sort of feathery sort of dusting of earthy peat, a little bit of licorice, a little bit of herbal note coming through. Lovely, lovely maturity. And again, it's got some kind of crisp, salty notes as well, which all add up to a really, really good nose. Palate. Quite dry, quite peaty on the finish in actual fact. Really nice chocolatey, mockery, coffee tannins. All really, really soft, really harmonious. Again, it's got some lovely age to it. It's kind of hinting at that sort of baked fruit character. But, oh, that is chocolatey. That is real dark chocolate finish, 90% cocoa kind of thing, which sort of dries the mouth a little bit. But it just lingers. It's just got that sort of lovely, sort of dark, earthy kind of, mulchy kind of character. With a little bit of peat as well. And a bit of sweetness from the American oak. It's just all really, really nicely balanced. Okay, so moving on to the Victoriana. Let's see what the nose gives us on this end, shall we? Immediate charred oak character. Almost kind of not burnt embers, but charred wood, bonfire wood. And then some sweet fruits, some almost honeyed fruits, a bit of apricot, a bit of barley. It's a little bit of age. It doesn't smell quite as old as the 15-year-old. But there's some lovely sort of wood notes, some spices, very gentle dusty background peat. Yeah, I mean, not having tasted a great deal of Victorian era whiskey, it's difficult to say whether this is a ringer for Victorian whiskey. I would imagine it would have probably been slightly heavily peated and maybe a little bit more rough around the edges, I would imagine. But I could be wrong, but this is wonderfully smooth. I mean, what's that bottle at? 51.5? Doesn't feel like it on the nose. It's all really quite harmonious and getting some lovely, mature, dark honey kind of coming through now. But all the while, you've got that charcoaly smoke, toasted oak. But it's not kind of big vanilla-y toasted sort of American oak style. It's more subdued sort of charred. Probably maybe they recharred refilled casks. Possibly, I don't know. But getting a little bit of stewed fruit now. Lovely nose, absolutely gorgeous. Palate. Gets really sweet oak now on the finish. And again, that sort of charred oak character, the sort of burnt charcoal. But, oh, that is sweet finish. But it's balanced, again, by that sort of charcoal character, by the saltiness. Opens up with some nice baked apple. A little bit of cinnamon, possibly. Some barley, really intense, really sort of fragrant and a little bit woody. Certainly on the middle it does come across like that. There's a little bit of a tannin bite, a little bit of chocolatiness, sort of cocoa powder. But that finish is just absolutely sublime. Yeah, that is a very, very good bottling of whiskey. Okay, so let's move on to the first of the Springbanks. This is the 16-year-old local barley. Let's see what nose gives us on that. Quite delicate, elegant. Plenty of barley notes. A little bit of honey, some toffee. Wood smoke, a little bit of peat smoke as well. Elegant, really elegant. I mean, you know, Springbank is generally renowned for its sort of power and weight. Not often you come across, you know, a nose that's as delicate and you know, just elegant, really. Quite fishy. The fishy notes are coming through now. The coastal notes. Brine, peat. Aromatic. Just elegant. Just really nice. Touch of apricot. Oh, just fabulous, fabulously balanced. Palate. Lovely, malty, chewy finish. Classic American oak aged Springbank. A little bit tannic. Some lovely sootiness, some smoke, some peat smoke. Barley, quite fruity, quite fleshy, but that's all kind of held in by the should we say, slightly robust tannins, which Springbank is well renowned for. The fishy notes really, really linger, and it is just very, very good. I mean, it's just classic American oak aged Springbank. I just love that sort of almost gritty tannic character that their casks seem to impart, whether they're American oak or whether they're sherry casks. Probably not quite so elegant on the palate, but that's not, you know, doing it a detriment, I should say. It's got that just classic sort of American oak aged Springbank character. You don't want it to be all soft and kind of fluffy, because Springbank is not like that. It's got a bit of an edge to it, you know. I don't really think it needs putting any water with it. The alcohol is quite well contained. Certainly doesn't give you any burn on the finish. It's just all, you know, really nicely put together. So yeah, another classic Springbank. Right, so let's move on to the 12-year-old cask strength. Let's see what the nose gives us on this end, shall we? Really quite juicy. Yes, there's some classic tannins behind, but it's actually got some lovely, juicy, slightly raisinated sultana notes. Touch of butter, clean as a whistle. Now, I mean, one of the things that I have had an issue with this bottle in the past is that one or two have been slightly sulfur tainted, but certainly last year's bottling and this year's bottling have been absolutely spot on, clean as a whistle. Again, sort of coffee, mocha, dark, almost treacle notes, licorice, malt. Big, it's a robust nose, which is what you would come to expect from Springbank. But there is a sort of a lovely sort of coastal note that cuts through. It's a little bit of fishiness. That is really nicely balanced. Palate. Ooh, it's a bit of a dry finish. A little bit of bittering, but not too much. Oh, the saltiness on that finish is just really intense. It's sort of like, you know, really quite dry, you know, bit of tannin, bit of saltiness, but opens up with this sort of lovely sort of, you know, pruney, walnutty, sherry character, but it's again sort of like quite, not subtle, but it's not sort of OTT first fill Oloroso cask and nothing else. There's a fishiness that comes through, the sort of classic salty character that that you get from Campbeltown whiskies. Really spicy on the finish, you know, wood spices, a bit of pepper, little thread of peat that runs right the way through it, that sort of earthy, dusty kind of peat. Yeah, that's really impressive. I'm going to put a little drop of water with it and see what that does primarily to the finish. I don't think it's going to make a great deal of difference to the nose, but we shall see. Probably emphasises the spirit a little more in actual fact, a little bit more oiliness, a little bit more fishiness. The kind of the sherry character is kind of sort of moved back. Again, it's sort of displaying more of a kind of more of an American oak sort of character, sort of getting more of the spirit character rather than the sherry, but it's definitely there in the background. Let's see what the palate is like then. Lot softer, juicier, fruitier. Lacks maybe some of that sort of grippy tannic intensity, which is obviously emphasised by the alcohol. A little bit more fishy, a little bit less of the sherry, but still really nicely spicy. I mean, personally, I think you don't really need to add water to that at all, unless you're not really into those sort of like ooh kind of finishes. But either way, that's a lovely, big, robust, mouth-filling whiskey. Let's finish off with a bit of peat then, shall we? Or a bit more peat, I should say. Let's see what the nose gives us. Actually, by Longrow standards, it's quite elegant. Not that I'm saying Longrow isn't particularly elegant, but it's kind of, you know, more in your face and sort of, you know, chunky and peaty. But it's got some lovely sort of winey red fruits. Some dark peat. Malt, toffee, coffee, little bit of a medicinal astringent note coming through. It's certainly not as mad as some of the Longrow wood finishes have been in the past. Certainly I remember the Longrow Barolo finish, which was like, you know, a serious car crash. I mean, it was just like, you know, really, really good, but one hell of a car crash. This has got a little bit more elegance, dare I say, like I said, but robust. I mean, when, I remember a little while back now when we had one of the tastings at the shop, I put this one on and it went down an absolute storm, and it is absolutely gorgeous. Yeah, I'm getting some cherries, some almost strawberry notes kind of coming through. It's just really well balanced. The finish is light, it's not sort of overwhelming. Mind you, it would take a lot to overwhelm Longrow, it has to be said. Really kind of medicinal peat, herbal notes. Yeah, that's good. Palate? Tense, medicinal, bitter, chocolatey, a little bit of winey red fruits, a little bit of red currant, cherry. Oh, it's kind of sucking the moisture out of your cheeks, it has to be said. But oh, the finish is gorgeous. I mean, it's dusty peat wrapped up in that little winey note. Quite tannic, like I said, chocolatey, malty, dark. God, that is a lovely way to finish a tasting, it has to be said. That is a really impressive whiskey. God, I can feel those spices tingling on my tongue still. Really good. Okay, so let's sum this little tasting up. Pretty damn good, I think. If we look at the Glen Scotia, I think this has probably been the most successful series of bottlings that that certainly I've tasted. And I always knew that the Glen Scotia can produce some really, really good malt, but it just sometimes just kind of flattered to deceive, I suppose. Just, you know, wasn't quite up there, because I mean I've tasted quite a fair few bottlings and a few independents which have been, you know, absolutely stunning. But the double wood, I mean, that is just really just very, very good. Classic example of how to use sherry and not to overwhelm the character of your spirit. Just sort of like adds that sort of sweetness to it, because it's very difficult, or very easy I should say, to get it wrong, certainly when you're playing around with really sweet sherry casks. So really good. 15-year-old, lovely maturity, really well balanced, and just all round really, really enjoyable. The Victoriana, again, really well balanced. Whether, of course, it's like a Victorian style whiskey, it kind of has that sort of feeling to it, but it's maybe a little bit more softer, a little less rough around the edges. But even so, that is just, you know, fantastic whiskey. So, yeah, hats off to Glen Scotia. They've certainly released three very, very impressive bottlings. And on to the Springbank. Well, 16-year-old local barley, just classic American oak aged Springbank. You know, got some maturity to it, got some tannin, got some fishiness, some peatiness. You know, it's just all round really, really impressive. 12-year-old cask strength, again, you know, quite elegant for a Springbank, you know. Not huge sherry, it's quite restrained. Again, really well balanced peat, you know, chocolatiness, you know, tannin, doesn't need any water, just again, you know, really, really enjoyable bottle of whiskey. And finally, the Longrow. Again, can't fault it one little bit, you know, it's again, subtly finished, you know, the wood finishing doesn't overwhelm the spirit, but then again, it takes an awful lot to overwhelm the character of Longrow, it has to be said. Got some pleasant peat, you know, some wininess, just damn good, absolutely fantastic. And again, not particularly expensive, 50 something I think at the end of the day. So if it sounds like your cup of tea, definitely get yourself a bottle, that's all I can say. So anyway, that's this week's episode of the Show in the Bag. I hope you enjoy it. I hope you'll take time out to maybe, you know, investigate one of the Glen Scotia bottlings, or investigate any of the Springbank bottlings. Certainly I think the 10-year-old is now, you know, probably as good as I've ever tasted it. And you know, you kind of know what you're going to get with regards to Springbank if you love that slightly more tannic, woody kind of style of whiskey. But you know, anyway, so that's this week's episode of the show. Hope you'll tune in for the next one. I haven't got a clue what that one's going to be about, but anyway, that's it for today. So all that's left to say is good afternoon and good dramming. Cheers, love.